This is Radio Free Roanoke, and this is episode 136, T-Bone's Best of Roanoke Show. We continue with part two, Living in Alaska, with Mitch England.
Welcome to T-Bone's Best of Roanoke Show. Music, comedy, and conversation, featuring HB. The Honey Badger.
Honey Badger don't care.
Now, on with the show.
Yeah. I've been out there kayaking, and I've had little seals and sea otters come behind and check you out. And as soon as you turn around, you'll see them, doop, doop, they'll go right below the water. They're very curious, yeah. And the only thing that really hunts them are the orcas. But besides that, they're really playful. And they'll hit the rivers, though. So we'll be out there fishing in the rivers in the co-op. Sometimes they'll swim up. Well, they'll be right at the mouth, too.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, last time I went to the mouth, there's like three or four just chasing salmon all around the bay right there in the brackish water.
You mentioned orca. That jogs memories of SeaWorld and movies, and it's a killer whale, right?
An orca is a killer whale. Yeah,
you've seen those.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Now, have you ever jumped on the back of one and ridden it?
No, that's
it. Ain't SeaWorld, Tim.
Once you see them tear up a seal or something, go after it. I don't really want to get in the water. Yeah, they are all predators. Right. They are the predator, apex predator in Southeast.
Yeah.
On 250 and above, I would say easy.
Wow.
They're a killing machine.
They're just so smart, and they work in a group, and they're so big, and they're fast.
They work in a group.
Absolutely, yeah.
I didn't know that.
That's what makes them so deadly, yeah.
I've only seen them at SeaWorld and the dorsal fin is kind of bowed over.
That's when they're depressed, yeah.
That's what happens. They couldn't tell why it was happening, and that's
well, so they get fin rub. If you see them out there, too, they will move, so... My experience with them, I've had one, I believe it was a younger male, got kicked out, because you can tell by the size of the blade if it's a big male or not. I mean, sometimes those will be 5 or 6 foot blades. I mean, it looks like a
sword. That's what they call it, a blade.
Well, that's what it looks like to me. I mean, it looks like a little black butter knife coming out. That's what that was. Yeah. Mm-hmm. First time you see it, it's recognizable. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
But so I've had like a little rogue male. He'll kind of stay. He won't really get too shy around us. Now, you can't kind of butt up to him. He'll disappear.
Nah.
But he'll stay about, probably 50 yards from you.
Right.
And he was playing in the bay. I think he got kicked out because he's real social to go do his own, get his own pack going over pod or whatever you want to call it.
Uh-huh.
And then some of them, we had a few local ones. They'll pop up for a second, and you'll kind of get close to them. I think you'll be on plane going, and you'll kind of come up on them. And then they'll disappear. And they'll pop up like a quarter mile away. You'll see it just blow.
Okay.
But now, if they have a baby with them, they'll put on a show. Because that little thing doesn't know no better. So he's out there doing flips and stuff, just going, having a good time. Yeah.
He's entertaining the kid.
Yeah, no, it's the kid doing it. The kid's just going out. He don't know no better. He's just having fun. Yeah. He's a king of the ocean right now. He's got nothing to worry about. Yeah.
If you had to guess, Mitch, what would be the average length and weight of an orca whale?
Oh, I have no idea. See, I've never gotten too that's a good question. They're not the size of a humpback. And a humpback's probably like a school bus and a half.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's... All right.
I'd probably say like full length, 25, 30 feet of big. No, I don't want to say 30. I'd probably say high 20s.
Okay.
Yeah.
They're very mobile and agile.
Oh, turn on a dime.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, now, HB, I want Mitch to play you this little piece of tape he recorded. I'll let you tell the story, Mitch. But I want him to play that to you and see what you think.
All right.
So I'll tell you, so we were out there, this is on the Whale Side Pass. We're out there, so Craigside for sea lions, we have hundreds of them on this rock. You go out there, I mean, it's just covered. You can smell them, you hear them, they're barking at each other. You can see the old sea mass, they're 800 pounders, and they're just waddling around. So on Whale Pass side, though, they're on buoys. So they just get out of the water.
Up on them buoys and just ride.
I never see them on the shore, because I bet you something will eat them. That's why. They like to stay in the water.
They can always
safety.
Just sail away.
Exactly. A lot of your brown bears, too, a few guys will put their butts towards the water because there's no natural predators. So a lot of stuff's like that. So I think it's a safety thing.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm up there. We're just, looking at them, checking them out. In the distance, I see not one spurt. And you'll see, it looks like little mushroom clouds. That's what it looks like.
Spurt.
That's a,
okay.
That's a, yeah. Yeah. They're, yeah. and I see 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, oh, just shoot off it at once. I was like, oh my gosh, yeah. So we haul over there, and they put on a show for us. I mean, I stopped fishing at 1 o'clock. And
just to.
Yeah, I was 15 minutes away from the dock. Didn't get home till like 6, 6:30. We watched them for that long.
All right, put that up to the mic when you're ready.
So here is this one. This is one of the noises it made. I had no idea it could. I'll play it again.
Play it again. That sounds like a dinosaur.
I thought it was a T-Rex.
Yeah. That's just them breathing and taking a breath.
I don't know what he's doing at that. Because usually they'll come up and they'll blow. You'll see it and they'll do it and come back down. And I've heard him singing that. You can hear him sing at night. It's real soft. It's not like that.
Right.
When that came up, that vibrated my windows. It vibrated my chest. I felt like I was in a concert. Because that was only about 10 yards off my boat. Yeah. I was like, because what we're doing, we're around there.
Massive anyway.
Oh, yeah. We're following around. What they're doing is doing a bubble net. They're hunting in a pack, in a group. So there's a little bait up there, little herring, stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
So what they'll do, they'll go in a group and they'll do a bubble net. So they'll release a whole bunch of air and they'll trap them in there and they'll come up from underneath and grab them.
Yeah, I've seen video of them do that before.
And we watched them do it for 6, 7 times. So this one, you can kind of see it. The bubble net will start to form and you'll just see the ring.
Yeah, that was them coming up and getting together. I'm going to call it a bite, but I guess it's
they come up and
running them in their mouth.
Or they're trapped and they all come together, so just get them and
go. Yeah, they don't have any trouble eating there.
Yeah, and it is crazy to see them too because they're large animals.
Yeah.
And see them working together, it's just cool. And it's also just being around was really cool too. And everybody look for the tail photo. That's what you're looking for. Yeah,
that tail and flip out of the water and get to see the whole width of it. And
what's very unique about them too, it's almost like a fingerprint. You can ID whales by that.
Okay.
On their tail?
Yeah, there's a pattern on it.
Oh.
So each pattern is very unique. Yeah, so you can ID ones by their tails.
Fingerprint.
Exactly, yeah. Because there's white, black, some might be mixed, you know. You can ID the whales by their tails.
Now, is plankton, is that...
There. No, that's
another.
No, they probably have plankton. They're so small. Plankton's like microscopic.
Right, they are. Yeah.
I think other whales might get krill, something like that, a little more shrimp-like.
Krill, that's right.
But no, these mainly, I think, go after the herring.
Herring. Okay. Yeah.
That's why April's a really good time. You got your fish egg weather, which is the herring spawning on the kelp, and that's the time to go see whales because they are going off. April's a whale time.
That's the time to go. And I'm sure that's going to draw a lot of people. The fishing is going to draw.
That's probably the start of the season is April, yeah. Okay. So you come in here, hit some of your steelhead, hit some of that, go out there. It's still kind of nasty. You got your fish egg weather, so it'll be sunny and nice, and then just get 2 weeks of rain the next day. You know, it'll last for 2 weeks. Right. It's just like, okay. So it's fish egg weather is what you call it.
But tourists show up to see whales,
I'd say April all the way through October, yeah.
And fishing, that's the two...
Yeah, so if I had to break it down,
break it down.
You can go hiking anytime you want to.
Okay.
I mean, wintertime, anytime you want to. But if I was going to do, like, let's say it's like, if I was going to do it myself, I'd start in April with the river fishermen going out, hitting some halibut, stuff like that, banging the bottom, seeing whales. Just nice, easy, relaxing. I don't know if anything about steelhead, it's a fish of 1,000 cast. So you're not loading up on that one. Okay. A lot of times, too, your guys will catch and release. It's a fly fishing. It's like a sacrilegious thing. You know what I'm saying? Like, you got to just let that guy go back.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, they're really smart.
Got to be some size.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, some of them, I've got pictures of 65-pounders caught in nets all the way down to little 32-inch hens.
Wow.
So, yeah. So, they're big. They're a sea-run trout that can go back out the ocean and come back and not die. That's how they get so big. Salmon will kill them. They go back out the ocean. As soon as they hit the fresh water, a fungus starts getting on them. That's what that white stuff is. And it literally starts killing them.
Okay.
And biologically, that's why I think fishing the rivers is kind of, it's kind of pointless, but it's kind of not. They will not eat in the rivers. There's no point. They're there to spawn and die. They're not there to eat anymore.
Right.
So that's why you kind of have to, like, you know, kind of make them mad to get them bite out of anger or get a little tail slap.
Or
catch them right before they start doing it. Because if you're mid-season, they're dying.
They don't care about eating.
No, we're here to spawn, and that's my life cycle.
Wow.
Yeah, but now, steelhead though can go back and forth.
Hunting is that a that's huge. People show up for hunting, right?
Oh yeah, and so you'd probably start same time with April, maybe a month later or a little earlier. You would do your blacktails, so it's our time for blacktail.
Deer.
So we have whitetail here. Okay. Blacktail are smaller, a little smaller.
Oh,
A big blacktail is probably like 130 pounds.
Okay.
Yeah, so you'd catch them, hunt them, and then bear would probably pop up. Your bear hunters would come in. And it shuts down, I don't know the months, but it shuts down for 2-3 months during the summertime. That's when they have their cubs, and same with deer hunting. That's when they have their fawns.
Is it bow, rifle, different like they do here?
I think it's a little bit, but not as much.
Like, but there's,
I think there is, but I don't think it's not as selective here. Like, you know, you have rifle seat, you know, muzzle loader for 2 weeks.
Right.
I think it's green light, red light. Like, it's time to go. Yeah. Because a lot of people rely on that.
Okay.
Yeah. You got to think. There's no.
But I mean, is it, you can use a bow, you can use rifle. That's what I'm kind of getting at.
I got a 30-06 Tika. That's what we carry around. Okay. Alaska nice state stuff. Gun is a 30-06 lever action, I believe. Only state to have a state gun.
Yes, yeah, it is. I've never heard of that. Yeah, there you go.
Well, that's what conquered them. I mean, that 30-06 and put down a moose to a little grouse. Right, I mean, it's a really versatile gun. Good round, too. And bolt action, Tika, you want something to do the weather? That's what we carry on personally. And a Glock, it's for bears and halibut.
So when, like, would it be October or November where you start shutting down because of the weather?
Yeah, well, shutting down weather, and then literally everything in southeast, at least, I haven't spent some time mainland, revolves around the salmon. The salmon berries come in. The sea greens come in during the summertime.
Okay.
Literally everything is your summertime. That is, if you are indoors in summertime, I don't know why. You're recovering. You got to be doing something. But, I mean, summertime, it is go, 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 especially in southeast.
Right.
It is that much of a difference. I mean, everything's green and blooming. And then, like, when it hits October, everything will start to decay. The fish, you know, the rivers will smell horrible just because of the amount of dead fish.
Yeah, right.
I mean, it's just a ton of dead fish all the time. You got to think, all that biomass came up, and it's just there.
Right.
And bears, you know, they'll go out there like the fatty parts too, so they're not eating the whole fish. That's why we find fish heads, stuff like
that's
that.
That's why, yeah.
Yeah, so they'll go to liver, stuff like that.
A lot of carcasses and different stuff.
Yeah, that laying out in the rain for a month, that's going to smell real nice. Yeah, so that's why in October you're pushing it, you know.
Yeah.
You still catch fish, it's still fun, but you're about done until next season.
Now sunlight, daytime sunlight, how much does that alter compared to here?
So we don't really get it that much. It's more for the north you get, I believe south too.
Okay.
So summertime, and again, I'm southeast. I'm just out of Seattle, so it's not as severe as it is mainland. So mainland, when you get up more up north, you get that 30 days of night. You also get the 30 days of daylight.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, I believe it's in July. I want to say July 14th. Don't quote me on that exactly, but I believe it's in July. What happens, Will, the sun will be out, be nice and pretty and everything. By 11 o'clock, it'll be sunset. And it'll sunset till about 3:50, dip down for a second, come really right back up, 4:10. So it's never truly dark.
It doesn't, okay.
Yeah, for that day.
Some daylight.
And, you know, during the summer, your days are a lot longer. But now it's also the same in the wintertime. Several times when I went to school in the wintertime, I went in dark, came out dark.
Wow.
Yeah, and again, then you throw the rain on top of it too. It is very, very, I don't say miserable, but it is very miserable, during that time. And vitamin D is huge, especially if you're not used to it.
Okay.
Yeah, for me, I had huge deficiencies. I was on 10,000 units a day minimum, even during the summertime.
So sunlight is important. My wife talks about that.
It really is. Well, one of the natives' favorite fish, and I could never figure it out until I was trying to, like, break down the proteins and everything and looking at stuff, is sockeye. That's one of your types of salmon. Sockeye. It's a green head and a red body. I'm sure everybody's seen it, real famous.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Those are sockeye, I mean, they'll be blood red bodies and, you know, green heads.
Yeah.
So that's when they spawn, because salmon change when they spawn. They change their colors and they change a little bit too. But anyways, that fish per serving has 443% of your daily vitamin D.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, and also almost just as much protein as a king. I think a king per 6 or 8 ounce salmon, fillet is like 32 grams of protein. You know, a sockeye has your vitamin D and your protein too.
Okay.
And there's a lot more. You go beach netting for them and seining stuff like that for them.
Yeah.
And you get them in bulk, and that's what you jar up and keep for winter. And that is a traditional thing. It goes way back when. Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's touch on that. Let's touch on when you go there, or if I was a tourist or if you live there.
Yeah.
Let's talk about food. What are some of the, you mentioned jarring things, but what's the main food? I guess fish, right?
Yeah, I hope you're a good shot and good with the rod. Yeah. no, so
is there a McDonald's there?
No, sadly, no. So you go to Kenton, no, you ain't got nothing. There's not even street lights. I mean, like, stop signs, like stop lights? No. Yeah, there's nothing.
Okay.
Bring your own.
Yeah. Literally, when you leave the fair to go to Craig, it's your third stop sign. And that's half the island. Yeah, it's going across the island.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's very remote. Yeah. So for food-wise, you have a few options or restaurants if they're open. It varies, because the hardest thing up there to get is people to work.
Oh.
That is the hardest thing. No one wants to live there year-round.
Okay.
And some people do live off the land, don't really need it, and they have a better job. So the hardest thing is really finding people to work. That's across the board anywhere. So you have a few restaurants, mainly in Craig. You have two IGAs, which are Canadian-owned. It's weird, not sure why, but they're Canadian-owned.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really your grocery stores. Yeah. And then two liquor stores in Craig and Kowalk. And if they're open, they're open. You got Ann and Betty's Coffee Shop. Yeah. Probably kept them in business all summer. Oh, wow. I love my frappes, but that's really it.
That's it.
And you have Dockside, and a few of the bars have food now. They're starting to come up.
I'm sure they have like burgers and
the
normal. But
if they're open.
If they're open.
I can't tell how many times we went going to there, and it's on Friday, and there's no people working. They're on the side, like, sorry, I don't have anybody to do dishes, stuff like that, and it's closed. And we're just like, all right, breaking out deer meat or something like that. Yeah.
Well, what was that you were saying, Mitch, about storing fish in jars?
So smoking. So smoked fish is huge up there. Actually, Prince of Wales and Kowalk is the first cannery in Alaska. So historically, it's a huge historical thing. That's, you know, your pink salmon in a can.
All right. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
First cannery is in Kowalk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that's the first cannery in Alaska. So, I mean, that's where a lot of that stuff started. But yeah, so traditionally what you would do, go in there, you smoke it with cedar or alder. You know, you cut up in strips.
Cedar.
Or alder, yeah.
Or alder.
So that's another thing. So we have a lot of yellow cedar up there. Okay. A lot of it goes to Japan. A lot of our stuff goes there. But for us, you go out there, get it, it's just abundant. Just like we have trees here, ours is just cedar and alder up there.
Okay.
Primarily yellow cedar. We have a few red cedars in there. But anyways, do that, cut it up, smoke it, cut it into pieces that fit in the jar, and that's pretty much a jar.
Canning. It's canning, I guess.
It's really canning. Yeah, you do it with berries, jams, sea greens. Right. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Green beans.
Oh, everybody up there, you'll see, because it took me a little while to do it. I was like, why do you have so many mason jars? It's just like, oh, because there's a whole bunch of food, and that's what it's for. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's been really good, too, on hunting trips, too. You just break out a can. It's good. Yeah.
That's cool.
That's what I do, mason jars. That's pretty much all you do with it. You do a deer, everything.
Did you went to high school up there for a while, right? Uh-huh. How many high schools are on the island?
Well, okay, so, and when you think of high schools too, they're not our typical high schools. Everything is single A. Yeah. So technical schools, you have Kaufman Cove. They're big enough to have a basketball team. No football on the island.
And that's a high school.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's what Kaufman Cove, Heidelberg, then Kowalk and Craig. I'd say those are your only four. But like Kaufman
Cove. But they have separate elementary schools, middle schools.
No, it's usually all attached.
It's all attached.
Okay. Yeah, it's very, very small.
Which makes sense. You know, there's no sense in being separate as much.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's just so small.
It's not a one school, one room schoolhouse.
Though. No, some like Hollis is, though. Hollis is, But like, they're starting to come up, and like I said, the island really fluctuates sometimes, too. Depends on what's happening. You know, when logging was happening back in, I believe, in the 1670s, the place was booming. You know, died off. A lot of people left. Right. You know, that's why it's
population-wise, it varies.
Yeah.
And naturally, like you said, the summer.
Oh, summer doubles.
So
yeah.
Much more people there.
That's why everything's open, because it's worth it. You can get people come up, stay for 3 months, work. That's why a lot of people are seasonal up there.
Okay.
A lot of people don't really, you know, very few stay. Well, I wouldn't say very few, but a lot do leave during the winter time.
Now, you moved back here.
Mm-hmm.
All right. What was your reasoning?
Come back. Let's come back to civilization. Yeah, I mean, come back.
Because you did live there a pretty long time.
Right? Yeah, so last time I was going to go down to Florida to do some firefighting, but they cut that off because of COVID. I didn't know how long COVID was coming, and I already had my season in Alaska coming up. So I went ahead and left for that.
Okay.
Then COVID kept on happening, and nothing could open up for me that I wanted to do down here. So I was like, why am I going to go back? Yeah, I don't know what's going on. Also, I can't stay around my mom either. You know, she's got the three indicators for everything, so get around her. I don't want to do that at all. So I was like, I'm going to stay right where I'm at.
Yeah.
You got a good mama.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I can't take her out quite yet. Yeah.
And then, you know, you've going to be a firefighter here?
Yeah, I was. Yeah, I had a hernia that I had to pull out, sadly. But yeah, I'm going back in the spring.
Okay.
Good. Yeah.
Good.
Very good.
This concludes part two, Living in Alaska with Mitch England. If you've ever wanted to visit Alaska or Prince of Wales Island, stay tuned for part three as Mitch goes over all the tourism tips.
North to Alaska, go north, the rush is on. Big Sam left Seattle in the year of 92 with George Pratt, his partner, and brother Billy, too. They crossed the Yukon River and found the Bonanza Gold below that old white mountain just a little southeast of Nome. Sam crossed the majestic mountains to the valleys far below. He talked to his team of Huskies as he mushed on through the snow, with the northern lights a-running wild in the land of the midnight sun. Yes, Sam McCord was a mighty man in the year of 1901. Where the river is winding, big nuggets they're finding. Nug to Alaska, go north, rushes on.